nation's favorite celebrities.
Mm, I like that.
Paired up with an expert.
Oh, we've had some fun, haven't we?
And a classic car.
It feels as if it could go quite fast.
Their mission? To scar Britain for antiques.
Yes. Fantastic.
I'd do that in slow mo.
The aim? To make the biggest profit at auction.
Come on, boys.
But it's no easy ride. Who will find a hidden gem?
Oh, sell me!
Who will take the biggest risks?
Go away, darling.
Will anybody follow expert advice?
I'm trying to spend money here.
There will be worthy winners.
Yes!
And valiant losers.
Put your pedal to the metal. This is the Celebrity Antiques Road Trip. On this road trip, the past is really coming alive as we journey into antiquity with glamorous TV historians Susanna Lipscomb and Kate Williams.
Just Phil Thelma and Louise.
I do want to pick up a Brad Pitt, that would do.
I don't know whether he knows much about antiques though. That's what we need.
That's not all we need him for, babe.
We need an antiques expert.
We need to have a chat later, don't we?
And chat they might. These two have been chums for years.
So when did we first meet?
I think we first met at that History Today party.
Oh, yes, that's it.
They do have the best parties,
don't they?
They
do have the best parties.
I can imagine.
From, you know, parties in London to our little trip away to France.
Our holiday away together last year.
How lovely. Susanna and Kate are both learned writers, august academics, and regular presenters of history documentaries. They're most at home pacing the halls of our ancient homes and palaces and scouring the pages of dusty tomes, helping to bring the past to life. Susanna's specialism is the 16th century Tudor period, while Kate's is the 19th century reign of Queen Victoria, from whom she seems to have been taking some tips.
Gosh, it is a lovely car, though.
It is an amazing car.
You just wave like the Queen.
I know, I'm just waving at these children.
It's like, hi.
Yeah, I don't think
the car brings that out in you.
The regal little number they're driving in is a 1968 Renault Caravelle. Mon Dieu. Assisting them on this trip into the past are two antiques experts of a very fine vintage. David Harper and Catherine Southern. Definitely not crusted.
Happy?
I'm always happy with you, David.
Oh, yeah, and it's so good to be with you, Anita, honestly.
Anita?
What?
Anita?
Oh, I'm sorry, I was living in the dream world.
David, honestly. Today, these two are driving a 1973 Triumph Spitfire. I used to have one of those. With 400 pounds to spend, our two teams will begin today in the town of Bletchley in Buckinghamshire and then wend their way slowly south to do battle at auction in London. And what a battle that's shaping up to be.
I think you're sweetness and light, right? And yet, I think that actually, underneath, you're deadly.
It's you who actually is sweetness and light, but under it is a brutal beating heart of competition.
See, this is what I said. I thought you'd be competitive.
It's the Hunger Games.
Let's do a test.
It's the Hunger Games.
Let's do a test. Who's better at spelling? Did you just make an allusion to a game in which people end up killing each other? I think you did.
Just like the film.
Blimey. And with the game red in tooth and claw already, it's time for celebrities to meet experts.
Oh, look at that! That's very nice.
Look at the amazing car. Hello.
Very nice. Hello.
How exciting.
Well, you two look very good against that very
smart
car.
It's a nice car, isn't it?
It's a fabulous car.
I don't think he's looking at the car. They've decided that Kate will pair with Catherine and Susanna with David.
How would you like to take the driver's seat?
Oh my goodness, I can have a go.
And they're off.
I'll open the door for you, at least.
Oh, look at this.
Oh, no.
So I think she must be... She's got an inner core, you know.
Ah, she's driven.
Yeah.
And she's driving.
I'm thrilled to be driving this car because my mum was completely obsessed with these cars.
So your mum was fascinated by Spitfires?
She dreamt of a Spitfire. It was her dream car. And so I spent a lot of my childhood looking at them, and they became an object of desire when I was a child.
So that's wonderful that we're living your mum's dream.
I'm so excited.
So, with a tip of the hat to Kate's mum, they're heading for the town of Bletchley, Buckinghamshire. They're aiming for their first shop of the trip, Fenny Antique Centre. Careful how you say it.
Well done, brilliant. We are here. Oh my goodness. You ready?
Yeah, I'm ready. All set.
We've got shopping today.
You certainly have. And assisted by dealer Mags.
Hello.
Hey.
Nice to meet
Thanks
you.
Thanks for having us. We can make a potion in here.
We could.
Like George's marvellous medicine.
We could. And we could poison the other team.
We could poison the other team?
Seems a little extreme.
What about silver?
A hot trinket box. Mm. Heart-shaped trinket box. That's quite nice.
Mm. Easy to fit in your house.
That's quite nice, actually.
It's a jewellery box, hallmark silver, dating from 1901. And just inside, Kate's Victorian era of specialism.
£55. We could get that for cheaper, couldn't we?
I like your attitude.
I'm developing it.
You are, aren't you? Time to call in dealer Mags. Mags? Mags.
Got the box. It's from Birmingham, which adds to it because it's my hometown.
Oh.
So it's a Brummy box.
What I like about it is really nicely embossed. So you have got really nice little, all the flowers and the foliage and the swags.
But what can Mags do on the price?
I think we need to go down a bit.
Can you do 20-ish?
Well, I can do 30.
I think 25 is where it wants to be if we want to make some money on it.
I really want to be £25.
Who said that?
Okay, then 25.
Thank you. Thank you.
Happy
Max.
With that?
They'll take that and no mistake. Deal done. Kate's already managed to bag an item dating from her favoured era, the Victorian period. But finding something from Susanna's 16th century Tudor period may be a bit trickier. David and Susanna need to come up with a plan, methinks. Stand by.
We see a lot of 18th and 19th and early 20th century pieces. Okay. And really, if you boil it down, that's our periods, because yeah. They're the things that we're used to handling.
Yeah.
We don't very often find anything from any earlier periods, your favourite period. It would be fantastic to find something from that period. Very unlikely. But I think with your help, we might get it.
Well, I would be a total thrill. I would be ecstatic.
So, they've set themselves a high bar. They're driving to the Bedfordshire town of Ampthill as they aim into their first shop of the day, Lawson and Lee. How quaint.
Well, Susanna, here we are. Welcome to my world. So, what are you drawn to, naturally?
Well, naturally, I'm drawn to the books.
So, straight to the books they go.
If I were, you know, shopping with my own money, I'd definitely be getting this one. Look at that.
Yeah, isn't that beautiful?
Gorgeous.
So tell me why you love that so much.
Well, it's a history of the Reformation of the 16th century, so immediately I'm interested. So this is a great source.
It shape is, isn't it? With laser-like precision. Susanna's gone straight for a book on her own specialism, 16th century history. The book itself doesn't date from as early as that, though it was published in 1846, so it does have some age to it.
What I propose to write is the history of one of the greatest revolutions that had ever been accomplished amongst men, he says.
Oh, my gosh.
Anyway, so I think it is kind of cool, and okay. I would definitely get it. Okay. But I don't know much about the market of these things.
But you do know a man who does, Susanna.
The condition is good, originality. I mean, it's well over 100 years old. The gilded pages are lovely. Amazing, seriously, that we walk into a place and there is a book that so relates to you, it's unbelievable.
This is a sign. It's a sign. Okay. Can we keep it as a possibility and see what else is here?
You're not an easy shopper, are you?
No.
When you go shopping, do you put things aside and go and think about them a lot?
Yeah.
Oh, dear. Okay, all right. Now I know what I'm in for.
That's priced at £15.
I like that. I love it for you. I think it's brilliant. It sums up you. I'm amazed that you're not desperate to buy that.
Well, I am desperate to buy it, but I'm not desperate to give it away to anyone else.
So they'll keep their powder dry on that until they've searched the rest of the shop.
Cheers.
Now, what's this?
It's cool and trendy. That's it.
I mean, I guess it's coming back into fashion, but...
Is that a way of you saying that you don't actually
I don't like it very much.
It's a piece of retro glassware, probably dating from the 1960s. Susanna doesn't seem keen.
I better put it down.
So you wouldn't put that then on a 16th century coffer?
No,
you wouldn't do that?
No. And that's creating a sort of ripple of horror from my body.
Is it really?
Think about that, actually. Being a historian, you end up liking the stuff from the distant past.
Of course you do.
It's a no-no to retro then, and time to wander straight back and look at that book on the Reformation.
It's our job to help the auctioneer give it a nice description.
Okay.
Yeah, and the auctioneer will do a really good job. But I think if we could just flower it up a little bit with something from you, a little handwritten note as to what it was, maybe its historical importance, a bit of context somewhere, and you know, a little thank you from you for purchasing the book. Just slip it inside there. It may help it.
Okay.
Can I tempt you to have a go at it?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay.
Now, but if it's a choice between that and the red and yellow monstrosity.
Oh yeah, which one would you go for?
I think we'll be going with this one.
Would we really? Okay.
Surprise, surprise.
But can Susanna secure a good price with De Leclerc?
I'm going to put you right on the spot. I'm going to ask Claire to come over, and I need you to do a deal.
It was priced at £15. What might Claire offer?
12. Could you drop it to 10, please? For such lovely customers.
I don't know whether she believes that, but yeah.
It's really good at all.
She looked at me and thought, no, I don't think so.
Do you think you could do it? You will?
Yes. Great. I will.
Very well done.
Thank you very much. Okay.
Well done, and their first purchase is in the old bag. Meanwhile, back in Bletchley, Kate and Catherine are still scouring their shop for shiny items of interest.
That's quite interesting there. I mean, it's only silver plate, but that inkwell there.
Oh, yes. Is that an ostrich or an emu?
I think it's, you're right, it looks a bit like an emu, doesn't it?
It's more an emu, isn't it?
The inkwell or desk stand definitely harks towards Australia, mounted as it is, with an emu and a kangaroo.
It's a lot of money, £110.
This is 110 or best offer?
Best offer, eh? That sounds hopeful. The vendor is not in the shop today, so Catherine will put in a call.
Mr. Stewart, hello, it's Catherine Southern here. Hello, thank you very much for taking our call. We're just a little intrigued about your, the desk piece. What would be your very best offer on it? Would you? Okay, all right. Okay, I shall have a word with my colleague. Thank you very much indeed. He's had it a while.
Yes.
He will take 50.
Whoa.
Which is a bit of a drop.
Hey, a less than half price offer on that means it's definitely a strong contender. But Kate, it seems, is part magpie because she's spotted yet another shiny piece of silver plate. Oops.
I had a friend at university with a samovar. She used to give us just non-stop bubbling tea.
I would say that's high Victorian, the way that's really decorated.
Another Victorian item takes Kate's fancy. It's a samovar, a vessel for heating water for tea, traditionally used in Mother Russia. But the ticket price is a substantial £245, so they'll need to have a word with dealer Roy. Where's Roy?
Sir, might you be the owner?
I am.
Oh. We've seen something that we quite like.
Can you look in here, please?
It's like a trophy.
Oh, it's like a trophy.
Is it heavy?
We've won the quite pretty heavy.
Wouldn't it look nice in a sort of tea shop or something? It would look the business, wouldn't it?
I think I like it.
Yeah, but it looks as if an ornate finial may be knocked off the top. Could that be the angle to secure a better discount?
To be honest, I think it's a risk for us, though, isn't it? What is your
British Museum
absolute real best that this could be?
80. That's really pushing the boat.
I don't even know if that's going to be making anything, do you?
Not really.
Could you come to 75 and then we won't ask any more?
75, then.
Cool, that's tempting. But they have the inkwell in mind, too. Those two items are now offered at a total of £125 combined. Mags!
What I'm suggesting is, can we offer you 120?
That's 120. I'm glad you can add up, Catherine.
That's only £5 off for the two.
Yeah.
Are you happy with that?
Let's do it.
Yeah? Girl power.
Girl power.
Are we happy?
Let's do it.
Brilliant.
Thank you, Mags.
We've bought, three items.
Yeah.
Poor old Mags. That team certainly know how to bargain. That's three items in the old bag already.
Well done.
Meanwhile, David and Susanna are waxing lyrical about their shared love of engaging with history through handling old objects.
It is a thrill, isn't it? Because you have that real sense of tangibility, literally tangibility with the past. You get that, someone else was touching it, 500 years ago, 400, whatever.
I'm with you.
You would be. With Susanna's love of old books already well established, they're taking a break this afternoon to learn about one tome that had an enormous impact on 19th century Britain, Mrs. Beaton's Book of Household Management. They're driving to the Hertfordshire town of Hitchin, where they're meeting historian and biographer of Mrs. Beaton, Catherine Hughes.
Hello.
Hi. Do you like our ride?
What a gorgeous car.
It's great, isn't it? Not quite Victorian, but almost there.
He knows his stuff. Catherine's going to fill Susanna and David in on the very surprising story of the ultimate Victorian domestic goddess, Isabella Beaton. Her legendary book of household management was the first and still the best-selling homespun blockbuster, a hit on a scale that would put today's lifestyle gurus to shame.
So what sort of things are in it? Can you share some?
Well, there's 2,000 recipes for a start, which is absolutely extraordinary. So everything you might need to know. But not just that, also how to run a household, not just cookery, everything. How to splint a head, how to get stones out of horses' hooves, how to save somebody from something called apparent suffocation.
Apparent?
Different from actual suffocation.
Okay.
Anything you could need to know is in there.
I have to put it down because it's actually very heavy.
Yeah. Certainly is. First published in 1861, Mrs. Beaton's enormous tome contained advice on everything the up-and-coming Victorian housewife might need, taking in social etiquette, medical matters, and even legal advice, as well as her famed recipes. Gosh!
The interesting thing about Mrs. Beaton is that she's writing for people who have exactly this kind of kitchen. So she's not writing for very grand people with large staffs. I mean, it's very odd because we tend to think that she inhabits a sort of Downton Abbey territory. Not like that at all. She herself came from quite a modest family, and she was writing for people, women in particular, very like her, who had to run a household, who didn't have a lot of resources, certainly didn't have a professional cook, and they wanted advice.
That information must have been out there in different guises. Was she the first person to compile it all in one easy-to-use book?
Yeah, you're absolutely right. I mean, she's not an originator. What she is a compiler, a curator, if you like. She looks and reads everything, and then she puts it together in one digestible kind of package.
And this easy-to-use formula proved to be a real winner.
And how many copies did she sell?
Well, it looks as though in the first year she might have sold 60,000 copies.
60,000?
Which is enormous. Yeah. I mean, as for how many copies it sold overall in Britain, it looks as though it's probably the most successful book bar the Bible.
Wow.
Wow. But despite this extraordinary success, the real story of Mrs. Beaton's life is little known.
So, who was this woman? Where did she come from?
Well, it's interesting, isn't it? Because we tend to think that she must have been a very substantial matron of, I don't know, about 55.
It's definitely the idea of her I have in my head.
Mm. Absolutely.
An elderly.
Stout.
Stout. Yeah. A little bit of a dragon, slightly frightening.
Yeah.
Well, if I told you that actually she was 21 when she started work on it, she was 25 when it was published, and very sadly, she was 28 when she died.
I'm absolutely astonished.
In 1856, when she was just 20 years old, Isabella Mason married a professional publisher, Samuel Beaton, and together the couple began to release articles on cookery and domestic matters that evolved to become the Book of Household Management.
She was writing just at the moment when the British publishing trade was undergoing this vast expansion. I mean, paper was much cheaper. Taxes had been lifted on certain kinds of publications. So suddenly, you can put together these really, really large books quite cheaply.
That, together with an expanding urban middle class, meant they found an eager audience of young housewives.
She has a real talent for writing very, very precisely, very clearly, because that was very, very important with the recipes. Prior to her, recipes tended to be terribly vague. Cookery writers would say things like, take some flour. She's one of the first people to put the ingredients at the beginning of the recipe. So prior to her, believe it or not, you would read the recipe and then you would suddenly, three-quarters of the way through, come upon the fact that you needed three lemons and sadly you didn't have them. She's writing for beginners. She's writing for women who don't instinctively know how to cook, like herself.
Although Isabella died tragically young following complications in childbirth in 1865, her book went from strength to strength over the following century and beyond.
So she only lived for 28 years, but strangely, you know, she still lives on because of this book.
Yes, absolutely.
Meanwhile, Kate and Catherine are enjoying the Hertfordshire scenery.
They're going on this amazing 50s trip through the countryside.
Sounds good to me.
I feel like Bridget Jones going on a mini break. It's amazing.
Quite. The next destination is the town of Letchworth, where they're aiming for their next shop, past and present. That looks pretty.
Good. Let's shop.
Go for it.
Kate likes something that tells a story, where we can look at it and we can think about its history.
I like things that tell a story.
Where it's come from.
Yes.
Dealer Michel Marbel may have something with a bit of a local tale to tell.
Have you seen the basket on the floor there?
I have seen that. I did actually just look at that.
It's from a business in Hitchin that was called Letchworth Hill Laundry. And they did laundry for years
L-H-L.
And years.
L-H-L.
Yes. Right.
Yeah, ticket price on that is £70.
Well, I think 70 is steep.
I think it's very steep.
What would maybe do a deal with you?
I think it's steep. While Michelle looks into that, they'll keep browsing.
In life, you can't afford everything you want, can you? I wouldn't mind a yacht with a hot tub, but I can't have one.
You're right. Let's carry on. Tried. Doesn't work.
I quite like this.
And this is Royal Albert.
But so where's that from?
Royal Albert Bone China. Now, you quite like a bit of Roy. Haven't you done quite a lot of work on the royal family?
I have.
You've reported on
weddings. Yes, I've reported on the weddings and the coronations and every royal event. I've done that and written on Victoria and Albert and written on the Queen herself. So I have a lot of royals in my life.
Royal Albert is a British ceramic maker granted a royal warrant over a century ago, and it's still trading today. This cup and saucer dates from the mid-20th century. There's no ticket, so Kate will ask Michelle for a price.
How about 15?
15. We'd have to go much lower than 15. It's supposed to
maybe
be for auction, and we say it would have to be £5, wouldn't it?
Oh, you push a hard bargain. Okay, do you want to do a deal?
Okay, they'll put that cap aside at an offered £5, but we'll keep looking for more treasures.
Meaty, money-making stuff.
Go for it!
All right.
Go for it,
Kate. I'm on a mission. Just thought this was quite a nice set of knives, these beautiful blue bone handles here.
The vintage knives have £15 on their ticket, another to add to the list. But she's still going. What else has Kate spied?
This is sort of weird. Oh, you know, I'm not. Come on, Mr. Boss.
Careful now. Oh, dear.
Oh, gosh, I could have saw that dropping then.
It was close, Catherine. The unique retro vase probably dates from the 70s or 80s and is marked up at £20. You're right, Duck.
Why?
Well, it's a bit horrid.
I would never picture you next to this vase.
No, it's not really but I think it's so horrid it could be good.
Do you know, you're right. But they do now have a sizeable haul of items set aside. The linen basket, the cup and saucer, the knives, and now the vase. So, make your mind up, time, eh?
But what we could do is put it all together in a crazy lot.
Would that be too weird?
No. All that stuff combined is currently sitting at £115. Now, Michel Marbel has an answer to the very, very, very best price for the lot. What is it?
I think I've done you a deal.
What's
that?
Yeah.
Yes.
How about
65?
Yes, Oh!
Are we happy?
I think that's got to be the answer.
Are you happy with that? So we've got...
It's so crazy.
It's really crazy.
It's so wild, it might just work.
Yeah! So that whole bundle of stuff will form one auction lot. Gosh, let's hope the gamble pays off. And that buy ends this first frantic, fun-filled frenzy of buying. Nighty-night. A mere rest can't keep these history hunters off the trail for long. Oh no! The morning sun finds Susanna and Kate ready to do battle once more.
So, how was your day yesterday, Kate?
It was really fun. We got some things. I think I learnt a lot, actually.
There's quite a lot of pressure on today to get lots of good things. And we're historians. I feel the stakes are high.
I'll say. But what did David and Catherine have to say about their celebrity charges?
We had a really good day yesterday.
Tell me about it.
Well, there's no stopping Kate.
Susanna was the same. Her first bit of negotiating was effortless. She oozes confidence.
So far, Kate and Catherine have four lots. The Victorian Trinket Box, the Australian Inkwell, the Samovar, and the job lot of vintage items, including the linen basket. They have £190 left to spend today. While Susanna and David have bought only one lot, the book about the Reformation, they have a whopping £390 left to splash. And on this lovely country morning, everyone's feeling very chipper.
Oh, hello, you two. Don't they look fantastic?
Beauties. I love them in this car. You really suit this car.
I'm getting used to Susie driving me.
For another day. Thank you. Oh, madness.
Let's get this show on the road, then.
Go on.
Okay, enjoy your day.
And you.
It's not starting.
See you later.
Right.
Not clicking.
What's the matter?
Oh.
The car's conked out. Looks like they'll need a push start.
You push as hard as you can for about half a mile, and then we'll back it. Okay, go. Ready?
David's such a gentleman, isn't he?
Are you doing this as well?
Yes, I am.
Okay.
Go.
Go. There we are.
That's
better.
More
that's
like
it. That's it.
Punch in. Second gear.
Keep going.
Go.
Come on. Oh, Lord. It seems Kate and Catherine have had enough of this lark, and they're off.
Not very far.
Oh, very amusing.
Oh dear.
Oh dear, you're so sympathetic.
Do you want us to tow you?
Yeah, it'd be great. Thanks, yeah.
Would you mind? Shall I get the rope out? Have a nice day.
We are actually leaving.
I'm sure Susanna and David will figure that one out. Having abandoned their opponents, Kate and Catherine are feeling competitive.
If I was being really hard-headed about money, what should I get?
I think yesterday we were buying things that we really loved. Now we've got to really be a bit strategic and think about what is going to really make us some money.
Make some cash.
Yeah.
Cold, hard cash.
Oh, goody. Susanna and David have finally managed to start their car, and it's game on with them too.
I feel a particular sense of revenge, I think is the word I'm looking for, given that they abandoned us in our car.
Crikey, this game's really hotting up as they drive towards the town of Dunstable. Susanna's a seasoned traveller, and there's one country she loves to visit above all.
How much time did you spend in India?
I've been there 7 times.
Oh, right.
I love it so much. Such beautiful countryside.
And colours.
Colours, amazing food.
Gosh, yeah.
and, I mean, glorious things. I mean, the artwork.
Yeah.
It would be amazing if we could find something Indian today.
Well, that's something we'll look out for.
With that thought in mind, they're motoring to today's first shop.
Look at this. I mean, stuff pouring outside. Oh, straight in.
Look at this.
Oh, I say, what are we looking at there?
Isn't this a beauty?
Hey, like a vintage seeking missile. Susanna's straight to an object once again.
If I have children, I think I'll get one of these rather than the modern things. Doesn't it look amazing?
It is absolutely amazing. Is it Silver Cross? Is it actually the brand?
It is.
It isn't.
It is.
Is it really?
Is that a special brand for prams?
Well, yes.
The British company Silver Cross was founded in 1877 and lays claims to inventing the world's very first baby carriage. This is probably a mid to late 20th century example.
So it's in really good condition. Is there a kind of retro interest?
Yes.
Maybe?
Yes, there is.
They're taking note of that quality perambulator and strolling inside to meet the dealer. Richard.
Hello.
Hello. Pleased to meet you.
How do you do?
I'm Richard.
Susanna.
Pleased to meet you, Susanna.
I'm Tim. This place is absolutely stuffed.
Does it make you feel daunted by seeing so much stuff?
Excited. I want to get going. That's
good. Oh, that's great. Nothing scares you, actually, does it, really?
Heights.
Heights.
But hopefully that's not going to be...
There's no heights involved. No heights involved. Okay. Only lows.
Yeah, well, no, we're going to have some highs as well. We're going to find some good stuff.
High quality, low ticket is the name of this game.
Well, another nice looking thing is this brass tray here.
Yes, definitely Indian. Now, that's got age.
I feel.
Do you want to have a look at it?
Yeah. I think this is a thing of beauty.
Inspired by Susanna's love of all things Indian, they've alighted on a brass tray from that very subcontinent.
OK, tell me about this. Why do you love it?
It's just the delicacy of the carving.
Mm.
I mean, it looks just like a fine thing. I mean, it's a beautiful tray.
Date-wise, what's your instinct?
Early 20th century.
Yeah, absolutely. I think it's the period of the Raj, isn't it?
How amazing.
Much as they love it, Dave is not sure it will stand as a lot on its own, so they're looking for something to go with it. Another Indian piece, perhaps.
We could make a tray of delights.
Yes.
Couldn't we?
Yes.
Tray ball. Something else though's caught their attention.
Okay, that is seriously for nothing. I mean, it's an incense burner. It's not fabulously old, but it wasn't made last week.
That's beautiful.
It's fantastic.
It's a sensor for burning incense, ticketed at only £12, and probably hailing from East Asia.
It could be, it's maybe Buddhist then.
It's probably Buddhist. I think you would probably say it was early 20th century, mid 20th century. In a much earlier style, but it's got the look. And I'll tell you what, it's got the price, £12. That we should be running out with that.
That might be quite nice with our brass tray.
Do you fancy that tray?
I really like the tray.
And I really like that.
So, with tray and sensor, off to Richard they trot. Ticket price on the two combined is £30, so watch out.
How much are we going to pay you for them?
£30 would be good.
Ah.
Yeah.
But we...
But if we weren't to pay you £30, what would you accept for them?
Oof, 40?
Ah, very good.
I think 25 is where I'm at.
But will he go any lower?
I'll knock another pound off if it makes the difference. There we go.
You didn't even have to speak.
I didn't even. I just had to stand here.
That's it.
And exude this sense of reprimand. 24, okay.
Have we done it?
Let's go for 24.
Deal done there, then. But David's still on the hunt.
Well, I can't keep my hands off proper period furniture. And this thing screams. You wouldn't believe it. Early 19th century, circa 1820, the Regency period. It screams it.
Scream away! These shelves are priced at £18.
I promised to show Susanna something real and antique, and I think this is the first real antique I'm going to show her.
And so he'll corral Susanna and Rob, the dealer who owns them.
I've got to tell you, I think they're ridiculously cheap. Now, I shouldn't be saying that. I know I shouldn't be saying that, but I can't help it. I'm out of control.
Put yourself together, boy.
£18?
It's a very good price.
Tell him it should be more.
No.
No?
You're really bad at this negotiating.
I know, you're a bad influence.
I don't know what's happened to me.
Yeah.
£15.
£15.
What do you think, Susie?
I think we take them for £15.
Shall we have the shake his hand?
Yes.
We'll have them at £15.
Yet another buy in the bag. But they've still got an eye on that classy vintage pram outside. It's marked up at a substantial £180. Nothing babyish about that.
In auction, it needs to be well sub 100. Yeah. It really does. Are we going to get well sub 100, Rob?
The best I can do is 95. 95. I think that's a good buy.
There's a twinkle in his eyes, though. I think there's a bit of flexibility there.
I'll show him another fiver off.
You're being very fair.
I think you'll do well.
That's very generous.
That's a very productive shopping excursion.
Can I get my shelf unit in there? Hang on, if you're going to be doing all the pushing, I might as well let you do that as well. How's that?
Okay, you hold it steady.
And I'll guide you through. That's it. To me.
It's always the way, isn't it? Always the women's work. Always the way.
There you go.
Careful, David.
That's it.
I like you very much.
I'll follow you. I'll follow you. At a distance, I'm quite embarrassed at this point.
Like a rag and bone man. Now, Kate and Catherine already have four items, so they're taking a break from buying.
Why does it feel like driving this amazing car? Isn't it incredible?
But it's also quite sporty. I feel quite sporty.
I feel completely girl power. I feel we could be in LA going along together with a palm trees at the top down.
Well, they're not in LA, but they are aiming for sunny Luton. As well as a history buff, Kate's also a dedicated follower of fashion. So this morning, they're going to learn about the enormous role that the Luton area played in the world's fashion scene in the 19th and early 20th centuries. They're heading for the Hat Factory, where they're meeting Luton cultural head of collections, Elise Naish.
Oh my goodness. Oh, I love it. These are incredible.
Right up until the 1990s, this building was a busy working hat factory, and it was the millinery industry that transformed this town.
Luton's association with the hat industry goes back to the 1700s, but it wasn't till later that really took off, you know, sort of the 1800s.
So Luton was hat central. It was one of the key industries here.
In the heyday, we had, thousands of companies working around and over 1,000 staff. So it was absolutely, you know, huge economic infrastructure and employment in the town.
So Luton was hat central. Were other countries competing, or was it all about the British hat?
No, there were other countries competing. Italy and Switzerland were two of the major centres where hat production was coming out of. So Luton really had to compete with the quality that was coming out of these
countries.
Absolutely. People used to go and sneak to other factories and see what they were
producing. Hat spies.
Industrial hat spies. Absolutely.
That's my job. I'm going to be a hat spy.
They would come back, they would work out what plaits were fashionable, what the colours were. You wouldn't believe the sneaking that went around.
So some of the work ladies could have been hat spies sent in to get ideas and nick the patterns.
Could well
be. Like Willy Wonka.
Yeah, absolutely, yes. They could have well been hat spies in terms of that sort of thing.
Wow.
And whether engaging in hat-based espionage or not, the industry kept one particular part of Luton's population in work.
It must have created this incredibly skilled workforce, because you just look at the sort of workmanship on there. Amazing. And a lot of it would be women, I presume.
It also gave women the power and money in terms of an occupations. And in fact, a lot of the hat companies were actually run by women.
Really? So the women were the breadwinners?
I really think they were. Luton was said to be a town where if you wanted to come and find a wife, you were more than likely to find
because of all the hat makers.
Because there were so many women involved in the industry.
To look for a girl.
This competitive industry fed an appetite for fashionable chapeau at a time when hats were de rigueur daily wear for everyone in the country, a trend that continued right up until the post-war period.
But in the 1930s, Luton was producing, 70 million hats. But
a year?
Yeah.
70 million hats a year?
70 million hats. When you think of everybody wearing a hat every day...
There's not that many people in the United Kingdom at that point.
Well, you had your work hat, your Sunday best hat, you had your special occasion hat.
It wasn't just one.
No, it wasn't just one. And, fashions change, so you had to keep up with the Joneses and have the latest model as well, too.
And Luton's milliners are still at the fashion vanguard today. There are still around 10 hat makers in the town, and Kate and Catherine are visiting one of its most venerable. Philip Wright runs his family hat making business, which was first established in Luton in 1889. So he's the ideal person to show Kate and Catherine how a felt hat is made. First, Philip takes a sheet of suitable felt, which has been soaked in water, and shapes it over a heated aluminium block.
So, we pop the felt up, and over a period of 10 minutes, the felt will gently dry.
This gentle drying process gives the hat its shape.
Now is the time to take it down.
It's all about precision, isn't it, here? You've got to be very careful.
Oh, I love that. That's amazing.
Suit you, Kate. Meanwhile, David and Susanna are still on the lookout for another item, and they're heading to their next shop.
It's all in the hunt. What we are today, Susie, we're treasure hunters. Yes.
We are pirates. Pirates of the antique shops.
I've been called worse.
Arr-gimmer. They're aiming for the Hertfordshire town of St Albans, where, arriving at Ballytoe's vintage marketplace, which today has quite a crowd.
Oh, you're all out enjoying the weather. Very nice.
Good to meet you all.
Which direction do we go?
Way.
Brilliant.
Thank you.
They better get searching. Oh, goody. More hats.
Don't worry, it is vintage and very dusty. Hello. Look at
I'm
you.
Sure that should be worn at an angle, shouldn't it?
There's one behind for you.
Oh, right, okay. Oh, yes. Yes, sir, right there. Angled or not angled?
Not angled.
Very fetching. But they better look sharp, as Kate and Catherine have now caught up.
This is war.
I know. Can you hear them? Let's move.
Hi.
What are we going to do?
I'm in here. You can come in if you want to, but it might be a bit scary.
What are you doing amongst those clothes? What are you doing?
Hello!
David, where are you?
Oh, hello. Oh, hello.
What are you doing, David?
Hello.
I gave the game away. I didn't hide very well.
That was such bad hiding.
Anyway, lovely to see you.
Oh, yeah, great to see you.
See you.
Not trying to avoid you.
Have you bought? Not hiding or anything.
No,
I think you should go over that side.
Yeah.
That side looks like it's got so many things. I think you should go there.
Thank you for that
helpful advice, Susie.
They don't want us around.
They don't want us here.
We'll go.
Was it conveyed subtly enough?
I think they got the message.
It's packed. It is a jamboree. Poor. Look at him.
What?
Look at that.
An ant.
It is an ant menu holder.
It is indeed. This large metal fellow is ticketed at £150. Gosh.
Don't you think he's kind of cute? Little friendly person who'll offer you a menu.
No, cute doesn't come to mind when I look at that. Nasty.
So, Catherine's well and truly put the kibosh on that. They better keep looking.
Well, Catherine, what do you think about that?
I think that's lovely.
No.
50s.
Oh, my God. Catherine, 50s. Have you just 50s. Approved of something I've come 50s. Up with? 50s. Your 50s, yes.
I wouldn't 50s. Use it, but I think
cranberry
it's lovely.
And gold water set. I like that. I could use that. I could have that. I think that's really pretty.
This set of vintage jug and glasses was ticketed at £48. But since then, one of the original five glasses has been lost from the set. They might be able to negotiate a knockdown price from dealer Eric. Eric?
It does say on the ticket five.
Yes.
And there's only four.
There are only four there, yes.
So could that be, what, 10? Can it be 10? I think that's... Yeah?
15.
12.50?
Sold.
Thank you, Eric.
Very well.
Great doing business with you.
And you.
Thank you, Eric.
Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Goodbye.
Thank you, ladies. Bye-bye.
Nearby, the other team are still looking for another item, or are they just messing about? Puts you in the shade, doesn't it?
So that.
You want something that nobody can truly value, that no one's ever seen before.
Like a laundry box.
No. Like.
Like this. What is this?
It's an ant.
It's an ant.
It's an ant.
Now that is outrageous on so many levels.
Ant menu holder.
Oh, it's a menu.
About the ant.
It's a menu holder. Oh, I see. That makes sense. It's a menu holder. That's
well,
very
does
cool.
Does that make sense?
Quite. They too have discovered our metal friend, but this time it's our celebrity who's unconvinced.
This is the antiques road trip.
It's £150.
It doesn't want to be. It really doesn't want to be. I need to speak to someone and say, look, how long have you had the ant menu holder? I don't know. As long as the antique centre's been here, quite probably. Yeah, exactly. No, nobody wants him. Can we buy him for 30 quid? He's not exciting you, I can sense that. Even though he is a genuine
ant. I'm trying really hard, but, I mean, it's different.
Everybody, I mark my words, everybody that walks into that auction will go home and remember that they saw a metal ant menu holder.
Now, I've come to trust you
yes.
in the last couple of days. Do you genuinely think we can sell this?
He does. So David will go and speak to the dealer.
You get to know and get to love the ant whilst I find a human.
That's a really alarming thing to say.
Certainly is. While Susanna contemplates this turn of events...
Yeah, it's kind of growing on me. It's a weird creature, but increasingly endearing.
Are you talking about me or the ant? Right, I've
both.
Spoken to a human. He's called the fellow that owns the ant.
Right.
And not surprisingly, the ant has been here for a very long time.
I think we can see that, yeah.
Okay. Now, we can buy the ant 50 quid. That's it.
That's good.
I want that ant. Do you want the ant?
Okay, let's get the ant.
Shall we have the ant? We bought an ant. You bought an ant on the Antiques Road Trip.
Yeah, I'm quite anti myself. Now, both teams have all their items for auction, and it's time to unveil their purchases.
Shall we call our collection eclectic?
Eclectic is certainly one thing it is, yes. Antique is another thing.
Antique?
Yes.
Do antique. I buy an ant?
Is that the ant?
Did you buy the David ant?
Come on.
Are you ready?
Oh, there it's the ant menu ant. Holder.
And then we're going to go like this.
I adore
hello.
That. Amazing. Is that Silver Cross?
That's yes.
So beautiful.
That's
when's
perfect.
That? Where's that date from?
I think that's probably 1970.
Have I ever had a baby in it? It's pristine.
That is absolutely
no, it has been used. It's got patination. Yeah, it has. But
don't forget our other beautiful
yes.
things.
No, you've
how
got
much
lovely
did you pay
things.
For the pram? How much did you get the pram
really
for?
I really like the pram.
What did we pay for the pram?
90
yeah. for the pram, yeah.
Pretty good.
I really really rate that.
The pram is very popular. But what are their other items?
This was our first purchase. You couldn't have chosen a more apt item.
Susie wants how beautiful it is.
That yes.
Is so it's 1846, and it's a history of the Reformation.
No way.
Yeah, so it's all about Luther. So it's about the 16th century.
Yeah.
Perfect.
It's a beautiful book. And it has a lovely inscription, which is Thomas Rogers, the gift of a young lady.
I think that's so. That's very well suited.
It really is. You couldn't get better, could you?
No.
All very positive. But what will Susanna and David make of their opponent's haul?
I have exactly that teacup.
You do not.
I do.
That's quite a coincidence, isn't it? But what about the rest of it?
And there's more.
My
right.
goodness
me. What
is
me.
That? How much have you bought?
That's disgusting.
It's disgusting.
Which one? Which one's disgusting?
Her. She doesn't Which stop. One?
The vase, it seems, is not a hit.
It thing. Competes with the ant for weirdest thing
Fish
ever
vase.
On the road trip.
I
it's
love
horrible.
It.
You love it?
You? There's a charm in ugliness, isn't
yes,
there?
Yes, but you say you love it.
I do love it.
Do
I do.
You,
I think
David?
It's wild and wacky.
Says the man in the peppermint green trousers.
Are you selling 4 objects as one lot?
Yes.
That's really good for us, by the way, just so you know.
What do they make of the massive samovar?
That would have been rather
yes.
good, wouldn't
yes,
it?
Missing a finial, I see.
Missing a finial, yes.
I really like that.
We are miles apart. And we wish you the very best of luck at all.
I'm sure
luck
you do.
You too,
I'm
too.
Sure you do. We'll see you at the auction.
See you there.
But what do they have to say when their opponent's backs are turned?
Well, what do we think?
I love the pram. I think that could go for a lot of money.
Okay, their stuff. What's your favourite of theirs?
The samovar. I mean, I think the little trinket thing is quite nice as well, but I think they paid for it what it's worth.
I think I was with you and you're the best, so we have to win because you're a genius.
I like house. Stuff. I mean, maybe I'm just getting attached to it now, you know.
Okay. Even the ant.
With both teams set on victory, it's almost time to put the first hammer down. On this road trip, we began in Bletchley, Buckinghamshire, and find ourselves now aiming for auction in the North London area at Southgate. Susanna and Kate have commandeered the Triumph and are on their way.
Oh, it's fun to give this one a go.
I know, it's an amazing car, isn't it?
Bless them for letting us try it out.
See, these houses here, I think they could be enhanced by an ant.
Possibly.
Or a vase.
Hopefully they're lived in by lots of yummy mummies who want that pram.
Of course I want that pram.
Today, our battleground will be Southgate Auction Rooms, where David and Catherine await.
Oh, look at these two gorgeous creatures. Aren't they wonderful?
Hello.
You don't disappoint with the trousers, David.
He never does.
So lovely to see you.
So handsome.
Hello. Lovely to see you.
Are you ready to go?
Let's remind ourselves of who bought what. Both teams started with £400. Susanna and David spent £189 on five lots, while Kate and Catherine splashed out £222.50 and also have five lots in today's sale. Our auctioneer is Bill Carroll. For the off, what does he make of our team's buys?
The samovar, no, I like this. We sell samovars here quite a lot, but it's quite an unusual one, silver-plated.
And what of the ant menu holder?
It's unusual, I suppose. Would you want it outside your restaurant? I think not. But it's an unusual item, so it's hard to say, really.
No, yeah. Thanks, Bill. Great moustache. First up is Susanna and David's book on the 16th century Reformation, accompanied by a dedication from Susanna.
20 pounds, 25 pounds, 30 pounds, 35 pounds, 40 pounds, 45 pounds.
You're performing well.
All done at £45.
Hey, that turns a nice little profit for them. A very positive start.
Thank you. Now
it's Kate and Catherine's eclectic lot of vintage items, including that linen basket.
Ten pounds. Are we all done then at £10?
It was a bit of a mixture.
Last time.
That lot's hung out to dry, but there's still everything to play for.
I think £10 was
unbelievable.
It's Susanna and David's brass tray now, inspired by Susanna's Indian travels along with the Asian censer.
£40.
You'll get the end.
20, 25, 30.
Woo! You're riding
on. Are we all done at £25 now? Are we all done then at £25?
Oh.
Ouch! Not the flyer they were hoping for, but it's just about in the black.
£1
profit.
Kate and Catherine's set of 1950s jug and glasses meets the room now.
Starting £20, 20 on the deck, 25 then. Are we all done at £20? That's it, 25. 30. 30 on the deck. No. Yes, 30 on the deck. 35. 40. 45, 50,
no, enough already.
50,
oh,
55.
Well done. Kate,
you've
got a new career
ahead of you. Are we all done at £50?
A crystal clear winner there, then. Well done, Kate.
That's very good.
The 19th century hanging wall shelves for Susanna and David now take their bow.
20, 25.
Go on.
25. Are we all done at 20 pounds now? For the very last time, are we all done at £20?
A modest profit means they're hanging on in there.
That's still something.
It's a fiver.
Now it's Kate and Catherine's Antipodean inkwell.
55 on the deck. Are we all done?
Oh,
she's bidding.
Oh, it's bidding.
60, 65,
oh, they're on fire,
70, 75, 80, 85.
Keep going.
90. Ooh. 95. 100.
Ooh. 110. Oh, this is very
120,
bad.
120.
It's very good.
Is it? It's good. It's good.
More than £110 now. Are we all done for the last time at £110?
Excellent work. Fantastic result. Well done.
Well done.
Another for Kate and Catherine now, the heart-shaped trinket box.
More than £50 now, are we all done at £50?
And that sells smartly to make a nice little profit. And now it's Susanna and David's most controversial lot.
We have bids on it already, to my surprise.
Don't say that!
Of course, it's our old friend, the ant menu holder.
75, 80 anyway.
Come on.
80.
Come on.
85.
Come on.
90.
Come on, ant.
Are we all done at £85 now?
One more.
All done at £85.
He certainly proved himself. The ant, I mean.
He didn't do too badly, did he?
I think that's pretty good. You love it now.
Come on,
I have to hand it to you. That was you.
Susanna and David's pram now. By Silver Cross.
£10 anywhere for the pram.
It's a Silver Cross.
Come on, £10. £10. Yes, it would have been £10. £15 anywhere. Are we all done for the very, very last time?
£10. That baby really went out with the bathwater. That's an unlucky loss.
David, I'm sorry. I'm so sorry.
I can't believe
help
it.
Help me, please help me.
After that big loss, it's the last chance for Kate and Catherine as their sizeable samovar is up next.
70 I have, 75
anywhere, this is going to die.
80,
oh, is there someone else?
85,
90, 95, 100, 110, 120, 130, 140, 150, 160, 170, 170 with you, sir. Are we all done at
£170? Oh. And that brewed up a very tasty profit for them.
What?
You tell are you what. Can you come with me on all of these?
I'm astonished.
You're really?
Yeah, she is, isn't she?
That's amazing.
Let's do the maths. Susanna and David began this trip with £400. After paying auction costs, they made an unfortunate loss of £37.30, leaving them with £362.70. They make a lovely couple, though, don't they? While Kate and Catherine also began with £400, but they made a smashing profit of £97.30, giving them a bumper total of £497.30. So, Kate and Catherine are victorious.
You're doing very well, you two. I can't believe it.
And it's time for our esteemed historians to hit the road.
Go, girls! Bye!
Bye!
That was fun, wasn't it?
It's been so much fun. I just wish we could do it every 6 months. It's been amazing, and you've been fantastic.
You did very well. It was great fun.
Cheerio, girls. You've been swell.
The nation's favourite celebrities.
Ooh, I like that.
Paired up with an expert.
Oh, we've had some fun, haven't we?
And a classic car.
It feels as if it could go quite fast.
Their mission? To Scar Britain for antiques.
Yes. Fantastic. I'd do that in slow-mo.
The aim? To make the biggest profit at auction.
Come on, boys.
But it's no easy ride.
Ta-da!
Who will find a hidden gem?
Don't sell me!
Who will take the biggest risks?
Go away, darling.
Will anybody follow expert advice?
I'm trying to spend money here.
There will be worthy winners.
Yes!
And valiant losers.
Put your pedal to the metal. This is the Celebrity Antiques Road Trip. Yeah. On this road trip, the past is really coming alive as we journey into antiquity with glamorous TV historians Susanna Lipscomb and Kate Williams.
It does feel Thelma and Louise.
I do want to pick up a Brad Pitt, that would do.
I don't know whether he knows much about antiques though. That's what we need.
That's not all we need him for,
Brad Pitt. We need him, that's not what we need, an antiques expert.
We need to have a chat later, don't we?
And chat they might. These two have been chums for years.
So when did we first meet?
I think we first met at that History Today party.
Oh yes, that's it.
They do have the best parties,
don't
they?
They do have the best parties.
I can imagine.
From, you know, parties in London to our little trip away to France.
Our holiday away together last year.
How lovely. Susanna and Kate are both learned writers, august academics, and regular presenters of history documentaries. They're most at home pacing the halls of our ancient homes and palaces and scouring the pages of dusty tomes, helping to bring the past to life. Susanna's specialism is the 16th century Tudor period, while Kate's is the 19th century reign of Queen Victoria, from whom she seems to have been taking some tips.
Gosh, it is a lovely car, though.
It is an amazing car.
Can you just wave like the Queen?
I know, I'm just waving at these children.
It's the like, stop. Hi.
Yeah, I don't think
the car brings that out in you.
The regal little number they're driving in is a 1968 Renault Caravelle. Mon Dieu. Assisting them on this trip into the past are two antiques experts of a very fine vintage. David Harper and Catherine Southern. Definitely not crusted.
Happy?
I'm always happy with you, David.
Oh, yeah, and it's so good to be with you, Anita, honestly.
Anita?
What?
Anita?
Oh, I'm sorry, I was living in the dream world.
David, honestly. Today, these two are driving a 1973 Triumph Spitfire. I used to have one of those. With £400 to spend, our two teams will begin today in the town of Bletchley in Buckinghamshire and then wend their way slowly south to do battle at auction in London. And what a battle that's shaping up to be.
I think you're sweetness and life, right? And yet, I think that actually, underneath, you're deadly.
It's you who actually is sweetness and light, but under it is a brutal beating heart of competition.
See, this is what I said. I thought you'd be competitive.
It's the Hunger Games.
Let's do a test.
It's the Hunger
Games.
Let's
do a test. Who's better at spelling? Did you just make an allusion to a game in which people end up killing each other? I think you did.
Just like the film.
Blimey. And with the game red in tooth and claw already, it's time for celebrities to meet experts.
Oh, look at that! That's very nice.
Look at the amazing car. Hello.
Very nice. Hello.
How exciting.
You two look very good against that very smart car.
It's a nice car, isn't it?
It's We've a done fabulous well. Car.
I don't think he's looking at car. They've decided that Kate will pair with Catherine and Susanna with David.
How would you like to take the driver's seat?
Oh, my goodness. I can have a go.
And they're off.
I'll open the door for you, at least.
Oh, look at this.
I know.
So I think she must be... She's got an inner core, you know.
Ah, she's driven.
Yeah.
And she's driving.
I'm thrilled to be driving this car because my mum was completely obsessed with these cars.
And so your mum was fascinated by Spitfires?
She dreamt of a Spitfire. It was her dream car. And so I spent a lot of my childhood looking at them, and they became an object of desire when I was a child.
So that's wonderful that we're living your mum's
I'm
dream.
I'm so excited.
So, with a tip of the hat to Kate's mum, they're heading for the town of Bletchley, Buckinghamshire. They're aiming for their first shop of the trip, Fenny Antique Centre. Careful how you say it.
Well done, brilliant. We are here.
Oh my goodness.
You ready?
Yeah, I'm ready. All set.
We've got shopping today.
You certainly have. And assisted by dealer Mags.
Hello.
Hello.
You're all right.
Hey.
Nice to meet
Thanks
you.
Thanks for having us. We could make a potion in here.
We could.
George's marvelous medicine.
We could. And we could poison the other team.
We could poison the other team.
Seems a little extreme.
What about silver? Hot trinket box, heart-shaped trinket box. That's quite nice.
Easy to fit in your house.
That's quite nice, actually.
It's a jewellery box, hallmark silver, dating from 1901. And just inside, Kate's Victorian era of specialism.
£55. We could get that for cheaper, couldn't we?
I like your attitude.
I'm developing it.
You are, aren't you? Time to call in dealer Mags. Mags? Mags.
Got the box. It's from Birmingham, which adds to it because it's my hometown.
Ah.
So it's a Brummy box.
What I like about it is really nicely embossed. So you have got really nice little, all the flowers and the foliage and the swags.
But what can Mags do on the price?
I think we need to go down a bit.
Can you do 20-ish?
Well, I can do 30.
I think 25 is where it wants to be, if we want to make some money on it.
I really want to be £25.
Who said that?
Okay, then, 25.
Thank you. Thank you,
happy
Max.
With that?
They'll take that, and no mistake. Deal done. Kate's already managed to bag an item dating from her favoured era, the Victorian period. But finding something from Susanna's 16th century Tudor period may be a bit trickier. David and Susanna need to come up with a plan, methinks. Stand by.
We see a lot of 18th and 19th and early 20th century pieces. Okay. And really, if you boil it down, that's our periods, because they're the things that we're used to handling.
Yeah.
We don't very often find anything from any earlier periods, your favourite period. It would be fantastic to find something from that period. Very unlikely. But I think with your help, we might get it.
Well, I would be a total thrill. I would be ecstatic.
So, they've set themselves a high bar. They're driving to the Bedfordshire town of Ampthill as they aim into their first shop of the day, Lawson and Lee. How quaint.
Well, Susanna, here we are. Welcome to my world. So, what are you drawn to, naturally?
Well, naturally, I'm drawn to the books.
So, straight to the books they go.
If I were, you know, shopping with my own money, I'd definitely be getting this one. Look at that.
Yeah, isn't that beautiful?
Gorgeous.
So tell me why you love that so much.
Well, it's a history of the Reformation of the 16th century, so immediately I'm interested. So this is a great source.
it is, isn't it? With laser-like precision. Susanna's gone straight for a book on her own specialism, 16th century history. The book itself doesn't date from as early as that, though it was published in 1846, so it does have some age to it.
What I propose to write is the history of one of the greatest revolutions that had ever been accomplished amongst men, he says.
Oh, my gosh.
Anyway, so I think it is kind of cool, and okay. I would definitely get it. Okay. But I don't know much about the market of these things.
But you do know a man who does, Susanna.
The condition is good, originality. I mean, it's well over 100 years old. The gilded pages are lovely. Amazing, seriously, that we walk into a place and there is a book that so relates to you, it's unbelievable.
This is a sign. It's a sign. Can we keep it as a possibility and see what else is here?
You're not an easy shopper, are you?
No.
When you go shopping, do you put things aside and go and think about them a lot?
Yeah.
Oh, dear. Okay, all right. Now I know what I'm in for.
That's priced at £15.
I like that. I love it for you. I think it's brilliant. It sums up you. I'm amazed that you're not desperate to buy that.
Well, I am desperate to buy it, but I'm not desperate to give it away to anyone else.
So they'll keep their powder dry on that until they've searched the rest of the shop.
Cheers.
Now, what's this?
It's cool and trendy. That's it.
I mean, I guess it's coming back into fashion, but...
Is that a way of you saying that you don't actually like it?
I don't like it very much.
It's a piece of retro glassware, probably dating from the 1960s. Susanna doesn't seem keen.
I'd better put it down.
So you wouldn't put that then on a 16th century coffer?
No, you wouldn't do that.
No.
And that's creating a sort of ripple of horror from my body.
Is it really?
Think about that, actually. Being a historian, you end up liking the stuff from the distant past.
Of course you do.
It's a no-no to retro then, and time to wander straight back and look at that book on the Reformation.
It's our job to help the auctioneer give it a nice description.
Okay.
And the auctioneer will do a really good job. But I think if we could just flower it up a little bit with something from you, a little handwritten note as to what it was, maybe its historical importance, a bit of context somewhere, and you know, a little thank you from you for purchasing the book. Just slip it inside there. It may help it.
Okay.
Can I tempt you to have a go at it?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay.
But as if it's a choice between that and the red and yellow monstrosity.
Oh, yeah. Which one would you go for?
I think we'll be going with this one.
Would we really? Okay, okay.
Surprise, surprise.
But can Susanna secure a good price with De Leclerc?
I'm going to put you right on the spot. I'm going to ask Claire to come over, and I need you to do a deal.
It was priced at £15. What might Claire offer?
12. Could you drop it to 10, please? For such lovely customers.
I don't know whether she believes that, but yeah.
Really
She looked at me and thought, no, I don't think so.
Do you think you could do it? You will? Yes. Great.
I will.
Very well done.
Thank you very much. Okay.
Well done, and their first purchase is in the old bag. Meanwhile, back in Bletchley, Kate and Catherine are still scouring their shop for shiny items of interest.
That's quite interesting. Yeah, I mean, it's only silver plate, but that inkwell there.
Oh, yes.
Is that an ostrich or an emu?
I think it's, you're right, it looks a bit like an emu,
it's
doesn't
more
it?
It's an emu, isn't it?
The inkwell or desk stand definitely harks towards Australia, mounted as it is, with an emu and a kangaroo.
It's a lot of money, £110.
This is 110 or best offer?
Best offer, eh? That sounds hopeful. The vendor is not in the shop today, so Catherine will put in a call.
Mr. Stewart. Mr. Stewart, hello. It's Catherine Southern here. Hello. Thank you very much for taking our call. We're just a little intrigued about your... the desk piece. What would be your very best offer on it? Would you? Okay, all right. Okay, I shall have a word with my colleague. Thank you very much indeed. He's had it a while.
Yes.
He will take 50.
Whoa.
Which is a bit of a drop.
Hey, a less than half price offer on that means it's definitely a strong contender. But Kate, it seems, is part magpie because she's spotted yet another shiny piece of silver plate. Oops.
I had a friend at university with a samovar. She used to give us just non-stop bubbling tea.
I would say that's high Victorian, the way that that's really decorated.
Another Victorian item takes Kate's fancy. It's a samovar, a vessel for heating water for tea, traditionally used in Mother Russia. But the ticket price is a substantial £245, so they'll need to have a word with dealer Roy. Where's Roy?
Sir, might you be the owner?
I am.
Oh. We've seen something that we quite like.
Can you look in here, please?
It's like a trophy.
Oh, it's like a trophy.
Is it heavy?
We've won the quite pretty heavy.
Wouldn't it look nice in a sort of tea shop or something? It would look the business, wouldn't it?
I think I like it.
Yeah, but it looks as if an ornate finial may be knocked off the top. Could that be the angle to secure a better discount?
To be honest, I think it's a risk for us, though, isn't it? What is your
British Museum
absolute real best that this could be?
80. That's really pushing it about.
I don't even know if that's going to be making anything, do you?
Not really.
Could you come to 75 and then we won't ask any more?
75, then.
Cool, that's tempting. But they have the inkwell in mind, too. Those two items are now offered at a total of £125 combined. Mags!
What I'm suggesting is, can we offer you 120?
That's 120. I'm glad you can add up, Catherine.
Well, that's only £5 off for the tea.
Yeah.
Do we? Are you happy with that?
Let's do it.
Yeah? Girl power.
Girl power.
Are we happy?
Let's do it.
Brilliant.
Thank you, Mags.
We've bought, three items.
Yeah.
Poor old Mags, that team certainly know how to bargain. That's three items in the old bag already.
Well done.
Meanwhile, David and Susanna are waxing lyrical about their shared love of engaging with history through handling old objects.
It is a thrill, isn't it? Because you have that real sense of tangibility, literally tangibility with the past. You get that, someone else was touching it, 500 years ago, 400, whatever.
I'm with you.
You would be. With Susanna's love of old books already well established, they're taking a break this afternoon to learn about one tome that had an enormous impact on 19th century Britain, Mrs. Beaton's Book of Household Management. They're driving to the Hertfordshire town of Hitchin, where they're meeting historian and biographer of Mrs. Beaton, Catherine Hughes.
Hello.
Hi. Do you like our ride?
What a gorgeous car.
It's great, isn't it? Not quite Victorian, but almost there.
He knows his stuff. Catherine's going to fill Susanna and David in on the very surprising story of the ultimate Victorian domestic goddess, Isabella Beaton. Her legendary Book of Household Management was the first and still the best-selling homespun blockbuster, a hit on a scale that would put today's lifestyle gurus to shame.
So what sort of things are in it? Could you share some?
Well, there's 2,000 recipes for a start, which is absolutely extraordinary. So everything you might need to know. But not just that, also how to run a household, not just cookery, everything. How to splint a head, how to get stones out of horses' hooves, how to save somebody from something called apparent suffocation.
Apparent?
Different from actual suffocation.
Okay.
Anything you could need to know is in there.
I have to put it down because it's actually very heavy.
Certainly is. First published in 1861, Mrs. Beaton's enormous tome contained advice on everything the up-and-coming Victorian housewife might need, taking in social etiquette, medical matters, and even legal advice, as well as her famed recipes. Gosh!
The interesting thing about Mrs. Beaton is that she's writing for people who have exactly this kind of kitchen. So she's not writing for very grand people with large staffs. I mean, it's very odd because we tend to think that she inhabits a sort of Downton Abbey territory. Not like that at all. She herself came from quite a modest family, and she was writing for people, women in particular, very like her, who had to run a household, who didn't have a lot of resources, certainly didn't have a professional cook, and they wanted advice.
That information.